Hi friends, hello, hi, how are you? I hope you guys are having an amazing day today. Hello, hi. So,
be on the camera.
So I got a puppy, his name is Oliver. This is Ollie. Look at the camera, it's the glow sticks. His name is Oliver P. Glow. The P stands for pupper because he will always be a pupper to us. Yes, we are in a matching shirt. This is a little D-Dog shirt that I found on Amazon that I think is adorable. This is my pupper. We adopted him. He's amazing. He's not gonna be two on the channel just because I want to let him like be a pupper. He does have an Instagram, so you can follow his Instagram. I'll link it down below if you guys want to keep up with all the pictures. I post there so much, but he is just the most adorable. Say hi. He's sleepy. He has a little bed right down here and he's sleeping at my feet. So if you hear puppy snores, that's him. I'm sorry. I don't want to leave him alone. Hi. So today's video, first of all, candle of the day is Frosted Coconut Snowball. I've been burning this one a ton. I feel like it's been in the last three videos, but I love this one. Today's video, so we're trying out kind of a different format. Definitely a little nervous for this video. I'm a little nervous about what you guys are going to think about it. So let me know, I guess. I've never really tried a video like this before, and you'll see what I mean. The editing and the style I'm doing it in is very different, but I have this kind of idea where I wanted to sort of analyze different people on YouTube's content and analyze, you know, how they started to where they are now and how it's changed, maybe some things that they do that's problematic, maybe some things they do that is really good, and just kind of analyze and discuss different content creators because I find it really interesting. So the very first person I chose is David Dobrik because I actually have a lot of thoughts about him, and I also just think his particular like channel growth and evolution is nuts. So we're gonna get right into the video, and let me know down below if you guys like this style. If you don't, if you like it, I think I'm gonna make it a series because there's like already a million creators I could think of that I would love to do this style of video with. So let me know. So David Dobrik is a 23-year-old creator who was born in Czechoslovakia. He actually is in the United States via the Dreamer program, which is actually something that's a little bit interesting that I want to touch on later about his like political views and how he feels politically. David actually started on Vine and he had over a million followers on Vine, but he was never like crazy popular on the app. He wasn't like his friends like Gabby Hanna and Liza Koshy. He more made money and was popular from Vine by making pages that were like those spam pages, like those pages that reposted Vines or just posted ads or things like that. And that's kind of how he made his money when he first moved out to California. He posted his first YouTube video on July 30th, 2015, and kind of from there it snowballed into what he has now, which is a channel that has over 15 million subscribers. I think there's definitely definitive phases of his channel, his content, and how his content evolved. The first phase is kind of the Vine phase. So his first video that he's ever posted on YouTube is definitely cringy. It's so interesting to watch actually because I think now his videos have such a comfortable and professional quality because he's made so many. Right now, his first video, if you watch it, it's interesting. It's mainly just him like hanging out with his Vine friends. He wasn't doing the 4-minute and 20-second model, which is what he now does in all of his videos. That's how long they are. So he wasn't doing that yet. The video is like 5 or 6 minutes long, and it's literally just him hanging out with other Vine stars, hanging out with his Vine friends. Throughout the video, it's kind of just him like hanging out with his friends, doing things behind the scenes of like behind the scenes of a Vine, and then random like Vine-esque skits. And I think that's pretty reminiscent of a lot of his first few videos. A lot of his videos are basically just Vines, but like longer versions of Vines. They're jokes that are short and to the point, and that's kind of like all the video is. When he first started YouTube, he's talked about this on his podcast with Jason Nash. He's talked about a lot that when he first started, a lot of his friends were kind of like, this is stupid, what are you doing? Which is ironic now because if you don't know David, he now has this thing called the Vlog Squad, where literally all of his friends also vlog and do vlogs kind of like he does. So it's interesting that he was the first person to start this. He's very much the most successful person out of that group, and everyone was kind of judging him and like not aware of like why he was switching over to YouTube, because at the time Vine was still doing really well. David has talked about too on his podcast that one of the reasons he started YouTube was because when he first moved to LA, he was feeling really not productive. He felt like he was partying too much. He felt like he was wasting his time there. He wasn't being a productive person and putting, you know, time into his arts and his craft, which is making videos. videos. So that was another reason that he started doing vlogs. He thought it would be a good way to just sort of hold him accountable to be doing work on things. Also important to note that during this time, a big reason his vlogs started gaining traction and becoming more popular is because, first of all, his relationship with Liza Koshy, which like everybody was obsessed with. Like all the kids who watched Vine loved it when two Vine stars got together. And also he was friends with people like The Gabby Show, who were very popular. Zine and Heath were very popular on Vine. So he kind of grew a little bit. He was not probably the most popular one at the time because of Vine, he was hanging out with people who were very, very popular on the app, putting them in the thumbnails, and then people were watching the videos as a result of that and subscribing because they ended up liking him. Even throughout this whole phase one of his creation, like his content was just okay. It was kind of, the videos were kind of scattered. There wasn't like a clear direction. He was doing these weird Vine skits that weren't really working. And the videos also, which is weird because I think now vlogs can be like 20 minutes long and that's like totally normal. Like Casey Neistat vlogs are like 10 minutes and that's like great. But I think for his style, they were a little too long. So when David switched over to this 4-minute and 20-second concept, it was kind of a change. So on February 8th, 2016, he uploaded his first 4-minute and 20-second vlog. And I almost feel like this is the start of phase two because it's the start of him taking his vlogging and his channel a lot more seriously. This is around the time Vine was kind of phasing out. Nobody was really interested in the app anymore. It wasn't as popular as it used to be. A lot of Viners were starting to switch over to YouTube and were taking YouTube a lot more seriously. So this is a time when you can see that David started putting a lot more work into his editing, a lot more work into his videos, a lot more money. He was really trying to invest in his channel to actively be growing it. You can see the definitive switch when it stopped being a side project and started being like the main hustle of what he wanted to do. During this time, he was still kind of relying on those Vine shticks that were really popular, like the little skits with the puns and the jokes. He was definitely still relying on that, but he was also starting to phase out of that into more just like day-to-day content, videoing his friends, you know, partying together, doing all of those things. And also during this time, his other friends started vlogging. More people started vlogging. So you were getting the same day from multiple different people's perspective, which was not something that had been really done on YouTube before. Sure, you had like Team 10, but that was very childish, kind of. This was adults doing adult things like drinking and talking about sex and doing things like that, who were videotaping their days and recording their lives in this friend group that seemed to be this sort of perfect friend group, right? They were the friend group that you always wanted. They were always laughing, they were always funny, they seemed to actually really like each other. It was always kind of jokes. I think David also very early on realized the importance and the power that clickbait held to YouTube, probably more than a lot of his other friends figured that out. He was always using people like Liza Koshy and Gabby Hanna in his thumbnails because he knew how popular they were and how they would get him more subscribers and more views. He also in the beginning used very, he still does this, but like especially in the beginning used very vague titles. Like it was like, I can't believe she did this. Or Girls Gone Wild, or like there was one about like Gabby Hanna cries about weight comments, or Gabby Hanna nose job, like things that he knew people were kind of talking about that would get him clicks in that sense. He ended up making clickbait merch, so I think he really just kind of hyped onto that and decided clickbait was the way to go. Now we kind of get into phase three, and this was the beginning of the pranks. So on August 12th, David uploaded a video about thousands of pounds of dry ice into his swimming pool. This video very quickly became it blew up. This video absolutely blew up. It was how I actually found David Dobrik, was through this video because I saw it on my Facebook, I saw it on Twitter, I saw it everywhere. So many people were reposting the video, and because it was such a short format, it was really easy to watch on a place like Facebook or something. If you're gonna post a 20-minute video on Facebook, nobody's really gonna watch that. But 4-minute and 20-second videos are really digestible, and it's a good amount of time that people could commit to watching something. So a lot of people found David through this video, and that's because it was insane. He dumped thousands and thousands of pounds of dry ice into his pool and created this insane smoke effect. His friends were jumping in. All of his other friends had been vlogging. So while this was kind of David's main idea in his video, again, you got to see this whole thing happen from different perspectives. And if you look at his analytics, this is definitely the one video that kind of started his catapult into superstardom. Once he saw the success from this video, from the dry ice video, he started trying to do more pranks like that, breaking world records. You know, ordering the world's largest pizza, doing things like that. So they definitely started having definitive roles in the vlogs, definitive characteristics. There were ongoing jokes between people like Alex Ernst, who was a Viner, where he would like break a table always. There was this ongoing joke about their friend Scotty, who he would always be the one nobody wanted to hang out with. He was always kind of depressing. There were these ongoing jokes that made these people less people-like and more character-like. As I said, David put more money into his content. Like, he bought a Tesla, which was like so much content for a long time on his channel. He made a lot of videos surrounding his Tesla. He would bring in these animals and have animals sit on people. Those were always really viewed videos that were really funny. The interesting thing during all of this is that David Dobrik's content, while it was a little bit more focused on like his friends partying, they were adults who acted like adults. They, you know, one of his friends smoked cigarettes, his friends would smoke pot and like talk about it. While all of those things were happening, it still had this kind of aura of family friendliness going on. Like, it would be like, most of the videos would just be like him surprising his friends with a grizzly bear or doing these crazy things, right? And there would be swearing, but it was nothing like crazy. There wasn't anything that kids would see and it would be like damaging. It was what you would see if you turned on a TV show on ABC, just adults getting drunk. It was all a little bit more family friendly. And I think another reason for that too, and an added aspect to this, is Liza Koshy. Liza Koshy's brand is incredibly family friendly. She almost never swears on the internet. She's very brand friendly. She's very brand safe. She's currently working with Nickelodeon. She does a ton of stuff. Her whole brand is based on being kid friendly. So I think her appearance in the vlogs definitely added a sense of kid friendly kind of content. It brought up David and her, because they were dating, did a ton of videos together at the time, which brought them both a ton of subscribers. And I think that made the vlogs a little bit more suitable for the fan base that he had, because his fan base was mostly younger kids. So then David and Liza broke up. They posted a breakup video, and the video had 59, I believe at the time of filming this, 59 million views, which is nuts. If you read the comments, it's actually really sad. Because their relationship was so public and so online, and it became a very large part of David's vlogs, which people really connected to David's vlogs. They connected to the friendships, they connected to the relationship. People were really upset. Fans were like genuinely devastated by this breakup, which, you know, I get. It's kind of, I think because they saw David and Liza as almost TV show characters who would like obviously have this very perfect ending, when they didn't have that perfect ending, I think it was kind of hard for kids to fully understand that. And I think this is also a really important thing to note, is as Liza was being phased out of the vlogs, because her and David were no longer dating, they're still friends, but like they weren't dating anymore. As she was being phased out, Jason Nash and Trisha Paytas started dating. Jason was definitely a key member of this sort of vlog squad, and him and Trisha started dating. So while you're phasing out a very family-friendly person like Liza Koshy, brought in a lot of young subscribers that are now kind of hooked on David's content, you're also phasing in a person like Trisha Paytas, who, well, you know, I respect her hustle, she's not family friendly. She's kind of the opposite of a Liza Koshy personality on the internet. The breakup with Liza, I think David and his friends started feeling a little bit more comfortable being a little bit more mature and adult content, despite the fact that kids were still watching his channel. A lot of David's vlogs after him and Liza broke up became very focused on Jason and Trisha's relationship, which I can't speak to how their relationship was in real life because I don't know them, but the relationship that they were putting online did not seem like a very like healthy, non-toxic relationship. There were definitely a lot of fights that David captured on camera, and a lot of really toxic situations happening that David would capture on camera. And I think this started making people kind of uncomfortable, because they were confused about why someone like David would just be fine with Trisha and Jason screaming at each other and feel comfortable enough to film it and post it. I also think it drew some criticism, because exposing to your young audience to a relationship like that is not the best thing to do in the world. I think you could make an argument that that's not the healthiest way to use your platform. With the exit of Liza also kind of came an increase in partying, which kind of brings us to now. Because David's vlogs now have definitely evolved into something kind of weird. I used to think, probably back in 2016 when he was in his sort of prank phase, that David's vlogs were some of the best content on YouTube, because they were really well made, they were super funny, he had this good mix of being family friendly while not being like a Lele Pons where you're just ignoring the fact that you're a 20-year-old person. It was a good mix of those things. In 2020, the vlogs have kind of evolved into this weird mix of like heartwarming, beautiful moments of like David giving away a car, or going to a college campus and giving away $10,000, or surprising, you know, this family that he loves to hang out with a $10,000 trip to Vegas, or giving people, you know, pretty much everyone in his friend group got a new car because of him. Helping a random stranger, you know, handing out iPads to random strangers. Like, it's kind of this mix of these really heartwarming, beautiful moments that he does, which are really, really sweet and really cool. And a mix of his one friend Zane getting just so obliterately wasted, like absolutely so so drunk that he's now hurt himself multiple times. One time he sliced his head open, and just recently he did something to his arm that required him to get surgery and be in a like arm cast for a really long time because he got so injured. His friends falling over, his friends puking, having to call ambulances because his friends get so wasted, his friends getting kicked out of clubs because they're so wasted, his friends doing really irresponsible things when they're so wasted. And also he started doing more stunts that are less lighthearted and fun and more potentially really, really dangerous. For example, there was a stunt that happened, I don't remember if it was a year or 2 years ago, but there was a stunt that happened with one of their friends who he was supposed to go over this swimming pool on this homemade ramp with a bike, like a motorbike. And he went over the ramp and it didn't work. He fell in the pool and he got punctured in his stomach. And the hospital people told him if it had been like 2 inches to another side, their friend would have died. That type of stuff is happening a lot where people are getting put in really unsafe situations, but it's just this culture now. The vlog squad has become a culture of putting out content, putting out views, and doing everything possible to monetize on these crazy situations they put themselves in. And it is definitely getting to a point where I think you could make the argument that the things that David is keeping in his vlogs and the things that he is putting in his vlogs are not conscious of the audience that he has. And at the same time, he's winning Kids' Choice Awards. He's, you know, hosting a Nickelodeon show that I think it's Nickelodeon. He's hosting a kid's show. His demographic is obviously children, or he wouldn't be getting these types of awards and these types of things happening. I know I'm kind of ranting now, but just to kind of sum all of this up about the evolution of him, David is one of the most well-known YouTubers on the platform, and I don't think there's any denying that. He has a level of mainstream success that not a lot of YouTubers have been able to achieve just by being more mainstream. He had like a one line in a Disney movie. He has captured the attention of mainstream celebrities like Kendall and Kylie Jenner. They've both made appearances in his videos, along with people like Howie Mandel, John Stamos. Josh Peck is obviously someone who's always in the videos, who's from Drake and Josh. There's musicians that he hangs out with, comedians he hangs out with. He's always kind of hanging out with famous people now, which has again just made his vlogs even more famous. I think the big thing here is, despite the problems I have with the things that he's promoting to his audience, the dangerous things he's promoting to children, his vlogs are mostly entertaining. Like, especially if you're his demographic, these vlogs are entertaining. Because they're so short and action-packed, and every second of those 4 minutes and 20 seconds is filled with entertainment and action and people doing things, they are entertaining videos to watch. I see why people like watching them, because they are genuine fun to watch. I would argue, though, at what cost is entertainment higher than sending at least somewhat positive messages to kids? I'm not saying you can never talk about sex. I'm not saying you can never, you know, make jokes that are adult level jokes. But I think the point at which David is showing his child audience, multiple members of his friend group almost dying multiple times, blatant objectification of women, and exposing them to things that most kids wouldn't be exposed to, at what point does the creator have to acknowledge their platform and acknowledge their influence and acknowledge the content they produce? And I think a lot of people's argument against this is, well, the parents should be more involved. The parents of these kids should be monitoring them better. And while I think that's true, I do think it's both. If you watched a David Dobrik video, like even a year ago, or even just based on a week-by-week basis, some weeks it's him giving his friend a car and promoting education, and like, that's awesome. Who wouldn't want their kid to watch something like that? And then the next week, his friend Zane jumps off a cliff and almost dies. And it's hard for parents in this day and age, especially with someone like David Dobrik's, whose content is so kind of on and off, it's this weird mix of family friendly while also not being, it would be difficult for a parent to know if this is the person their child should be supporting and watching. It's okay to show your friends drinking, right? But I would argue that if your friend almost dies or gets seriously, seriously injured while they're binge drinking, that glorifying that as humorous and funny is problematic. I think David Dobrik is one of those people who I'm like, he is a genius. Like, I don't doubt that he's a very smart person. He understood understood YouTube before anyone else did. He capitalized off of YouTube before anyone else did, and he had a great understanding of all of these things, right? I do think he shows a lack of caring in the people that he creates content for. I think he just wants to make the videos he creates, and he doesn't care that he's perceived as somewhat of a role model to a lot of kids. Because I work with kids, that's where my internship is right now. They love David Dobrik. Like, they want to be YouTubers because of David Dobrik. David Dobrik has inspired them to want to go down this path. So he obviously has a great deal of influence towards the younger generation. I think in a sense, people are almost scared to criticize him because he's so successful. He's never really gotten any drama. But I think there is room to criticize when you're not using your platform in a responsible way. And when you can't decide if you're a channel for children or if you're a channel for adults. Because I think he still kind of wants to be that kid-friendly channel because it does bring in money. It brings in, you know, even if he's not getting as much AdSense and ad revenue, kids are way more likely to buy his merch and support him in those areas, buy his tour tickets, those types of things. So he wants that child support. They bring a lot of support to his channel. They were brought in by people like Liza Koshy, and he wants to keep them there, but he also wants to make the adult content that he wants to make. He doesn't want to water down his content. It's a hard one, because I think he is a really good content creator. I think he's absolutely a trendsetter. You cannot deny that he's a trendsetter, but I also think it's like this weird complicated situation. I don't know. I'm really interested to hear what you guys think about this video and what you think about kind of how David Dobrik has evolved from his Vine days into being one of the biggest YouTubers on the platform. I think his rise is absolutely very interesting, and I think his kind of thoughts and mindset on it, which he does kind of talk about more in the Views podcast, is really interesting. Let me know down below what you guys think about all of this. I'd love to hear your opinions. Yeah. If you like this video, please like and subscribe, or just like, or just subscribe, or do neither. Honestly, just so happy you're watching me. Thank you so much for being here. My merch, my social media, and everything I'm wearing on my face will be linked down below, along with a link to register to vote. That's right. You can click on that link, you can register to vote, and you can be part of your democracy. It's a great thing. And if you're not from the United States and that link does not apply to you, please make sure you're staying informed on what's going on locally, federally, whatever way you can. Make sure you're staying informed, because the world absolutely needs more of that. I love you guys so much, and I will see you in the next one. Bye!